always keep in mind that when you're on the spiritual path, which is ultimately taking you to exchange nature for supernature, delusion for enlightenment, the Holy Spirit is engaged with your attention, but subtly. So whatever comes to your attention, realize that this is helpful. This is actually helpful. Even though it all just seems to be the natural flow here, and you say, where are my miracles? Where are my miracles? Well, what we're dealing with is really our attention. Our attention. Now, I've said before that I find there's several parameters that are super helpful here. One of them is that we realize that reincarnation, our attention gets pulled back to nature over and over and over. In fact, when we die, that's part of nature. The afterlife is part of nature too, actually. It's not part of supernature. We get pulled back into, for our love of form, we get pulled back into nature, bodies, over and over and over again. Realizing this, I found, is extremely helpful, because what happens is people can spend their entire life, and they do, programming something, their attention, programming their attention for the next life, for a role in the next life. And when they get in that next life, what happens is people who don't understand about reincarnation think, oh, this is just an innocent child with no program whatsoever, a blank slate, tabula rasa, and we just get to, you know, the environmental influences and happy home, and they'll be fine, wonderful people. They don't realize the previous lives they have been, may have been programming with tremendous tenacity, habits of attention, so they can play a role in this next life, you see. Even though they pretend to say, no, I don't know anything about reincarnation, they are actually preparing for next life. And so you may get someone that comes in here and they may just go right into this role, and it's like all the programming of their attention is already there. The death of the body doesn't disturb the programming of attention. Programming of attention is done from spirit. And so the children, we think, oh, what happened to our children? You know, why'd they be this way? And why do they seem so capable of this way, or just natural? And so we assume it's all natural, it's all inherent. So, this is just their inherent nature, this is inherent nature. No, it isn't. They spent previous lifetimes developing all this, programming their attention very, very, very with tenacity and determination. Bad habits, often very bad habits. Good habits also get carried over. The other very important parameter is that the cosmos is full of existence, of consciousness, life we call it. It's not really life, but there are many programming of attention going on other planets throughout the cosmos. A great deal. So, for instance, this world here is seen as a Mecca right now, attracting those who have programmed their attention in a certain way to this world at this time. Many of them come from other planets where they program their attention. A lot of them, I call it Gadget Land, which I was taken August 18th, 1999. I was taken in spirit while I was awake, actually. That was amazing. To another planet. My attention was transported to another planet, another realm. It was another planet. And I was like, it was as if suddenly the something parted, and I was aware, my awareness was aware of this other planet. And I called it Gadget Land, because everyone there was obsessed with gadgets, roboticism, gadgets. And I knew it wasn't this world, it was a different world altogether. And I took some time looking at it, and I said, my gosh. And then I had to pull my attention away, because I felt like I was going to die, because I felt this world was so oblivious to the spiritual path of salvation, oblivious. And I felt myself becoming oblivious to it, just putting my attention on it. And I said, oh, wow, this is terrible, this is horrible. And I realized that on this planet, the attention is programmed towards gadgets and technology to an extreme obsessive amount, extent. And that many of those who have programmed their attention this way, their consciousness having programmed attention, which is what consciousness really is, have decided to incarnate on this planet, planet Earth, because they feel it gives them a great opportunity here. This is where they want to be. That's why we have all these tech people in the world right now. They come in with all the savvy already. Once they get their body functioning, you know, and get coordinated and everything, right away they just understand gadgets, they understand how to program gadgets, they understand machine language, all this stuff is just like ingrained in them. Well, it's programmed in them, actually, through previous lives on other planets, actually. You see, if you don't understand this, you will get ambushed, because you will think, wait a minute, there's never been high technology on this planet before, so nobody can come into this world with high technology, because people think there is no other world. This is it. This is the only place in the cosmos with life. So they think, oh no, this is just, they're just learning at school. But how do they? No, it's not that. The people come in with already programmed with all this. They know way more than their teachers here. And that is for sure. They're like geniuses at it. And we think, well, we don't know how they got this way. I mean, just natural genius, or God created them this way. And so I think this is the natural flow of things. We think, no, this is God's only planet. So everything that happens here is exactly the flow of God. And it's not true at all. These geniuses, tech geniuses, have programmed their attention on other planets, maybe for many lifetimes. And so they come here with all that attention, programming attention in their consciousness, and they just get identified with a monkey suit, this flesh suit, and you know, as a baby, they identify. Consciousness identifies, and then they come in and get the body working, and then they are off and running here. This is how it works. So in both these ways, people in this world get ambushed if they don't understand reincarnation and life on other planets, and coming here and being born on this planet. So the whole world's been ambushed, but I wasn't ambushed. I was shown what's going to happen. I've been tipped off many, many times in many ways. Came into the world aware that this is going to happen, because in higher consciousness, so to speak, clarity, higher clarity, you can see the intentions and you see all this happening. You know what's happening. You knew ahead of time that all these people from tech planets would be coming to this world, as well as those from very barbaric planets came here too, because they also sensed a great opportunity here for their attention to play out here. They come here to play with, you know, their attention comes here to play. So I knew about it before I was even born here. And also after I was born here, I was tipped off many times through various means that this is what's happening here. Get ready, prepare. Don't be ambushed by it. So I wasn't ambushed by it, which is why I'm able to speak up and still maintain some clarity here. It's not natural at all. There's no such thing as this intrinsic nature, of bodies, of people, stuff. No. It's all the habits of attention that we have worked on for so long, and the play of those habits. And also, I became aware of my previous lives, the 33rd life I've had in identifying with the flesh. I'm not sure if it's all been on this planet or not, but the one just previous to this life, I was aware very clearly of what that one was about. And so I knew what my habits were, actually. I knew all my habits. And I realized I had all exactly those same habits of attention, got carried over from that previous life to this life without any question. And so I know for a fact that death doesn't do anything to our habits of attention, does not get rid of them at all. That's also very important to realize. And then I said, wow, if I don't want these habits, I better get rid of them. You know, I better get free of these habits, because they stay with you. This is why it is so important not to cultivate bad habits. Extremely important. A lot of people here, I call them the pagans, they think, no, this life is the only one. Do whatever you want, whatever feels good, whatever habits you like, is no problem. Because after that, it's oblivion. this is absolutely false. If you knew for a fact that your habits stay with you, this is a game changer. It is a game changer. For me, it was a game changer. So in a society that says, no, there's no reincarnation, there's no life on other planets, you can't reincarnate from other planets here, when you die, it's oblivion, this fosters extremely bad habits, a lack of seriousness here, and it's a terrible thing. If you knew your bad habits follow you beyond the grave, and you'll come back again, and then you get serious and say, well, wait a minute, I got to, and don't cultivate bad habits while you're here, at all costs. So it puts you into a very repentant frame of mind when you get all, begin to really get a bigger picture. The bigger the picture you get, the more repentant you tend to be, because you realize, wow, wait a minute, this is like a prison. You know, this nature is this horrible prison. But it's not exactly as the Gnostics have described it. I'm not really a Gnostic. I don't think I see myself as, I'm a Christian. But certainly the Gnostics had a very negative view of nature, which is certainly true. But the idea that there's some arch on or some terrible, I don't know what exactly I used to know all this, but you know, the basic Gnostic philosophy is the explanation. The explanation is for me, it's not so, it could be better, Okay, let's put it that way, it could be a lot better. Jesus' explanation that I've gotten, to me, it's accurate. I said, this is spot on. Now, I've said that the pagan mentality, the belief of nature worshippers, is the belief that the refining nature and making it more beautiful and more comfortable, that's where our happiness is. See, this is how we get happy. It's not true. Exchanging nature for supernature is how we are happy, because actually we're inherently happy. So trying to make happiness happy is unhappiness, actually. And nature, in a way, this idea of process, is our actually reflection of our own creativity and trying to make reality real in a funny way. Trying to make reality real. Reality doesn't need to be made real. When we try to make reality real, we're not accepting reality as it is, which is real, already real. It's never not been real. It doesn't need any protection. It doesn't need... So, we'll never be happy trying to make happiness happy. We'll be miserable, actually. This experience of nature is misery. It is misery. So trying to make it more beautiful and more refined is not the way. And neither is it trying to make it worse the way either. Just let it alone. Let it alone. Leave it to its own devices. Now, I was in the store today. And this lady, very pagan, sort of attractive pagan lady, yelled out to some other lady, "Hey, are those your kids?" She says, "Wow, those are beautiful kids." And then she said to the lady, and like with a lot of pride in this, just like, I make really beautiful kids too. Yeah. And it's like, this making like beautiful kids is like something that's like, you know, the most awesome thing, you know, like that. So in other words, the mindset of nature worshippers is to make more beautiful children, beautify, and of course comfort in nature, how to find comfort in nature. And this is not the path of salvation at all, And in a moment or two, I have to take a slight break now, and we will continue on with this reminder. See, it's very important to be reminded here of the truth. Otherwise, we will definitely fall into a stupor where we're unaware of the path of salvation. We're unaware of the Holy Spirit. We're unaware of habits, of how important habits of attention are. We don't know how to turn our attention to salvation. We lose all of this and see we slide back into bad habits very easily here. Very easily. So really one has to keep swimming against the current in this world to avoid these going back into really bad habits. Which is why Jesus said, love one another, encourage one another. Encourage one another along the path. This is what we're supposed to do. Okay, so this is all I'm doing. I'm encouraging others along the path. Having had some success on the path, and it seems, according to the Holy Spirit, that I've reached a certain level, goal, and getting invitation to visit Jesus' house, that means that, like, you're not going to invite someone over to your home who doesn't know how to behave there, right? You're going to invite someone who's going to feel comfortable there and relax and enjoy it. Yes, you're not going to invite someone that hates your house. So Jesus knows I'm not going to hate, supernature, his home. I'm going to really make the most of it. So that means I've reached a certain degree of we call it success, along the path. So I'm just encouraging others too, and I appreciate the encouragement others give me and have given me. That's what we're supposed to do, encourage one another. Don't fall back into bad habits. That's what it's all, That's the first thing. Don't fall back into bad habits. Cultivate good habits and work at it daily. This is the basic path. And why do we do this? Because the rewards are out of this world. Literally. The rewards are... And Jesus said, don't seek rewards in this world. Seek rewards for the world that is to come, meaning supernature, which is your goal. So the rewards are fantastic. So of course we're going to work at it with every effort we can get. So I'm not doing this just for no reason. I'm doing it because I know the rewards are beyond any measure whatsoever. So we need to encourage one another in this way, saying, hey, the rewards are worth it. This tough work, it's tough work. But the rewards, are you kidding me? I mean, you see some people working in this world for money. And boy, do they work hard. Oh, boy. Just never stops. Incredible. Okay, fine. Why? Because they think that'll get us money, success, and all this. And well, just think how hard we are working here, realizing that the reward we get is immeasurable, actually. So don't feel oppressed by working hard on the path, because the rewards that you're going to get are just incalculable. So keep at it. So I'll be back in a little bit. All right, back after a little while here. Now, buyer's remorse, buyer's remorse, buyer's remorse. This is what will happen to those who buy into this world, buy into nature. They get buyer's remorse at some point, guaranteed. So what we have to do is get ready to help them out when they get that buyer's remorse, because they won't know what to do, really. If you lose sight of the great river of skillful means to salvation, and you get buyer's remorse, you think you're stuck with this world. You see, you're stuck. Now, it's very simple. This world, nature, arises from a belief system, actually. And supernature arises from a belief system, too. They're very different belief systems. So what has to be done is you exchange one belief system for another belief system. That is what has to be done. And this is the work of the spiritual path, exchanging belief system one for the other, not combining them, because they don't combine, they're mutually exclusive, exchanging one for the other. So once you get buyer's remorse, what you do is you start working to change your loyalty. You gradually transfer your loyalty over to the belief system that results in supernature. Now the benefit of teachers, as for instance Jesus, is that he helps us with that. He shares this belief system of supernature. He shares that belief system with us so we can study it. We can consider it at length. It requires a lot of consideration because it's so different than what we're used to. So there's a continuity issue with that, you see. But it's very doable. It's very doable. To some, where I don't feel threatened by what he says, don't feel angry or disturbed. I may not get all of it. I may say, well, I don't quite get that. And he may say, you know, really not explainable. But, you know, most of what he says I agree with. So yeah, I really feel this is right. And overall, I feel, you know, what he's telling us is absolutely correct and truthful. And so, you know, just a general comfort zone, even though I may not get everything, you know, that's okay. I'm still working on it. And much of it is really has to be shown through experience, actually, you know, experiencing it. Otherwise, and getting a glimpse of it, I've been able to corroborate what he says. Oh, yeah, the vision of oneness, it's true. It's really there. This is true. So having spiritual teachings is very important. Having them available and supporting one another in spending time doing that is super important. How else are we going to get used to a different belief system if that belief system is not even present? If no one's telling us what it's like. So the goal of the pagans is to rid this world of any belief system except the belief system of worshiping nature. That gives rise to nature, believes that nature is real, it's our home, it's our identity is a product of nature, all this stuff. And getting rid of an alternative belief system of supernature, it puts everybody in a very bad spot, because once they get buyer's remorse, then, oh man, you know, wow. I've got a problem here. So, the way I see it is, we need to make sure that when they do get buyer's remorse, we're ready to really give a big push and help for them. For those who will repent, for sure, they'll say, wow, enough of this, no, I don't want this anymore. So have to have a lot of those who are very comfortable with the belief system of supernature in order to help out those who, when they get buyer's remorse. So going to supernature, dwelling in supernature for a while helps us get very comfortable with this belief system. So we know it's true, we know what it leads to, and then we can help out later on with absolute assurance, which is what they will need, absolute assurance. You know, have to get, you know, the big picture, get really clued in. So I would suppose this is something that will, you know, likely take place in some way. Now, can we do it organically in the world at this point? I don't know. Maybe some may be able to, maybe not. For instance, I was traveling down a freeway, great four-lane freeway, you know, just everybody just flying along. I looked up and I saw, it seems like congestion up ahead. I said, wow, it's unusual, middle of the day. Why so much congestion? As I got closer, I said, you know what, something isn't right here. And I was thinking, maybe I need to sidestep this. But the problem was the place I was going to sort of needed to go this route. I could have had alternative routes, but I wasn't really prepared with knowing how to get there, alternative routes. So I decided, no, I better stay on the freeway, see what's going on. Well, it turns out the whole freeway was shut down from an accident and got stuck in traffic for, you know, quite some time, and then had to deal with all those dive bombers who cut in to the turn. When you turn off the freeway, they go all the way up to just right before, and then they cut in there. And actually, they save about 20 minutes. They actually, because all the rest of us are waiting in the slow lane, in the turn lane, for a super long time, and they were whizzing by in the slow lane, which was kind of open now because while everyone was turning off the freeway to get off the freeway, so they saved, you know, maybe 15-20 minutes, and like 50 cars did that. And this is the mentality of Silicon Valley, is their time is more valuable than your time. This is just a basic feeling here, is the people simply don't care about taking advantage of you at opportunities. They just seize the moment and say, my life is more important than yours. My time is more important. I don't care. It's amazing. And everybody comments about it here, how incredibly, you know, unneighborly and rude and uncivil so many of these people are here, the way they drive, the way they cut you off, the way they just try to get any advantage possible here. There's the mentality of this place. Any advantage possible, let's seize it. Anyway, who knows? We're sailing along this world. We think everything's fine, and suddenly there's an accident somewhere. The whole thing, gridlock. Nobody's going anywhere. And then you get these very aggressive people who will try to seize advantage of the situation. Selfish people, you know. So, you know, those who want to continue on with their belief that nature is what they truly want, we'll see how that goes for them. I know eventually you get buyer's remorse. There's no question, 100% sure. Now, how soon does buyer's remorse come? I don't know. But there could be a lot of agitated people in this world coming up. Very agitated. I got agitated even. It's difficult to do, but I just like, you know, a few people cutting him, but it was just like, it was almost as if this is the thing to do, is monkey see, monkey do. And I've noticed in the Silicon Valley, more and more people are getting more and more selfish because they see others doing it and says, hey, you know, maybe I should do that too. So it's changed over time, where there used to be a few people do that, then more. Now it's a trend. It's trending. It's really trending in the Silicon Valley. The trending thing is to cut your way to the front of the line. Everybody else is waiting 25 minutes, and you're not waiting at all. Just and then force your way in, and just stick your car in there and force cars to let you in. You know, otherwise there's going to be an accident. So monkey see, monkey do in this world. Don't think that the world is going to be this wonderful place necessarily coming up. There could be, very well be, something that we need to sidestep, and we need to be aware of alternatives, otherwise we'll get stuck in this traffic jam. So I really need to take a look at a map and say, you know, what are the alternative ways to getting, if I had known that, I would have probably been able to veer off. I would have been more alert to it, you see. Very interesting. So the more we're aware of options, the better we can respond in advance when we see trouble up ahead. We say, oh, I see trouble. Now, I got a call, someone telling me, hey, the freeway's blocked. Where are you? It was just too late. It was just too late, like about 10 seconds too late. You know, just, so it is possible to know about things ahead before before warned about stuff, right? Imagine if I got that call and it was before I got to the traffic jam, I could have turned off on another freeway and missed the whole thing altogether. So this is like what we're doing here, is we're forewarning you, saying, look, it's good to know your options. It's good to know your options. There is another belief system. Okay. Jesus represents a different belief system. He doesn't believe the way we believe at all. And there are others also that have shared this same belief with Jesus. And they don't believe the way we believe at all either. That is for sure. So we need to be aware that a different belief system is possible. Absolutely is possible. We can get accustomed to it. There's no question about that. I've been able to do that. And again, I'm not up to speed like they are, but it doesn't bother me. In fact, I enjoy it. And I say, I like this belief system way better than the other one. And so I'll get used to it. You'll get more and more used to it. And so I feel like I have options. I have options. And therefore, make a turnoff before you get stuck. Once you get stuck in this traffic jam, you couldn't go anywhere. People are like almost going nuts, you know, trying to drive on the shoulder, saying, how do I get out of this? I'm stuck, I'm stuck, I'm stuck. And you know, in a traffic jam, that people ordinarily would be mild-mannered. They lose their temper. People start, you know, fraying. Their nerves just get frayed. And things can get really bad. I did let someone in right at the very end. Someone in Mercedes, this lady in Mercedes, just decided to zoom up to the very front and then just wait there, just waiting there, looking, you know, trying to get in. Yeah. And later I let her in, because what am I gonna do? You know, it's just like, but I was, you know, not happy about that. And later I saw her, she zoomed off on service plan. She actually lived in that place. So she knew very well that getting off this exit, she planned all along. She just decided to go all the way to the front of the line and then just cut in. That's all, you know, it's obvious. This is the mentality. They say, you know, I'm more important than you are, so you can wait. Know your options. So we're talking about our options. Know your options. Know your options. Know your options for sure. You'll see how this develops now. Willingness, you know, to speak up here and say we could. I mean, all along I was saying it's possible that there could be some relocation take place. That it's possible that there could be some troubles up ahead in this world. Really possible. And it's possible that there are people that will seize the opportunity to dominate in this world, okay? And you'll be stuck. And you'll be, you know, a low person on the totem pole. And you know, will be essentially dominated and enslaved here. It's very possible. Because you think that you don't have options. So, I certainly believe I have options. And if I do, everyone does. There's another belief system. This belief system certainly is capable of supporting a different realm. There's no question about it. And I was taken to a different realm and shown it. And I said, wow, this, not only is this some place different in the cosmos, I said, this is not even based on the universe, nature at all. This is what I realized. This is not even based on nature. It looks like nature, but it's not based on nature. And that's when I got the wow. Oh wow, where am I? This is not even some other planet. This is some other realm, not within the realm of nature. It's supernature, actually. So, knowing that buyer's remorse will happen, it's incumbent upon those who are responsible and know this to hang out in supernature. To be responsible, they need to be capable of then dealing with this buyer's remorse and saying, it's okay, don't worry. You know, the supernature is available for you. I've been there, done that, and you can do it, absolutely. And then they'll get after it and start that process of transferring loyalty from one belief system to another. It's very simple, actually. And it's important to see how simple it is and how basic it is, actually. So you don't lose sight of that. To have the basic overview of it and just know it will take time. It takes time. A lot of foolishness along the way, but a lot of progress along the way too, which more than offsets the foolishness. The right steps more than offset the missteps, that is for sure, on the path, no doubt about it. And the Holy Spirit is always orchestrating everything, so you become aware that I'm making progress here. Stuff that used to capture my attention no longer captures my attention. See, this is very important. Being forewarned of what's ahead is part of the situation. So you work at it. You realize, hey, buyer's remorse is coming up soon here. So we better really get after it. And if you want to help, either part of the problem or part of the solution. Once people have buyer's remorse, they're going to say, what do we do with this nature? We don't want anything more to do with it. We better know how to help out and advise at that point. And it could be coming up quite soon, actually. Buyer's remorse. I don't want to focus on it because we need to focus on the positive, supernature, the belief system, different belief system, which these videos have done. They focused on introducing a different belief system, getting used to the language, the ideas, the concepts, how they relate and how the whole thing relates and all of that. Now, this book, Journey Beyond Words, is certainly certainly shows a different belief system. Very much so. So does A Course in Miracles. So does the Bible, actually. And here's A Course in Miracles. That really shows a different belief system. And, you know, I spent 15 years just reading A Course in Miracles, studying it, thinking about it, basically getting used to it. It's not a different language, it's a different belief system. So it's a great, 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 great loving way to gradually get used to a different belief system. And don't struggle. You float down the river. You see, you float down the river. And then this one really doesn't mince any words, which is nice when you're ready for that. If you're not ready for it, it's too condensed. If you're not ready for it. As for instance, you are now, in capital letters, and you are now, this instant, the perfect Son of God. There is nothing you can do to change that. Truly, you can imagine all form of complication just as you've imagined this entire world. And in your imagining, you can even believe it true. But it has no effect whatsoever on what you are. See, it's like, wow, that's a different belief system, isn't it? You have been given all power within the universe as co-creator with God. But there is one power you do not, in capital letters, not have, and that is the power to change what you truly are. This world is a reflection of the power of what you can imagine. Indeed, it is oftentimes, usually, seems so real to you. That is but a reflection of the power of your imagining. But your imagining cannot change the truth of what you are. What is your salvation then? Your salvation is your freedom from your vain imaginings that this world is real. Your salvation is your freedom from your vain imaginings that you can ever be separate from God, that you can ever be split within your being and harbor conflict, that you can ever sin or have any reason to know guilt. Your freedom from such vain imaginings is indeed your salvation. Do I speak to you of salvation? Traditionally, you imagine that means you need to be saved from something. 'Tis only your vain imaginings from which you need to be saved. And what does it take to be saved? From that which you have imagined, but which is not real? What it takes for you to be saved from your imaginings is merely this. Hear me very well. Your salvation requires but one instant in which you wholly, totally experience at the level of feelings, beyond your thoughts and words, the truth that vain imaginings is all it is, this world. The truth that vain imaginings is all it is. In that instant, where within your being there comes a certainty, a knowing that indeed you are spirit, you are free, and truly this world is but illusion. That which you have imagined, in that instant, you shall be free. And never again shall you look upon this world with the same eyes. Salvation is very interesting as you choose to think about it. For salvation does not require that you do anything. Salvation is not something you can achieve. Salvation does not require hard work and struggle and tears and toil. Salvation requires only that you let go of the imaginings. See, like that. This is true. So this is a great departure from what we've believe salvation is about. Because what happens is, when we try to exchange belief systems, what we do is we take the new belief system and we put it in the context of the old. And that's what leads to all the trouble. But what else are we going to do? You know, familiarity reigns supreme. Of course, we look at the history of religion on this planet, and we see that this taking our old belief system and then taking the new belief system and trying to put it into the calculations in a lot of ways. A lot of half-truths, a lot of confusion, and trying to weed through all that confusion, oh my gosh, it's very difficult. So the more adamant teachers you have, the better. Who just say, forget about all that, don't worry about that, just keep moving. And eventually your context shifts so that now the new belief system is your primary belief system, and the old one is only seen in context of the new belief system. And that's when your progress, smooth it out and say, wow, this isn't so difficult now. So we've had all sorts of ideas in many different ways about, you name it, salvation, truth, the world, the body, time, space, our valuing illnesses, specialness, faith, you know, God's will, judgment, on and on and on. And one moment, please. Okay, that's it. Just hold on a second. Okay, back from that. Another category is... Okay, one of the categories that we've struggled with is love. And everybody talks about love, but Jesus has a different take on love, a different belief system. Now I would speak to you again of love. Love makes no judgments. Love does not compare. Love is not based on values. Love merely is. Love does not editorialize experience into categories of good and bad, desirable and undesirable, free and not free. Love merely is. Love merely is. There's a struggle between the two different belief systems as we get used to a different one than we're used to. It's inevitable, but totally necessary. So if you have a world that is overlooking this and just says, forget it, we're not going to do that, let's double down, well, then you're going to have people that are going to run into buyer's remorse, and you know, at that point they'll need to get after it. Let's see if there's anything else we can add. This book does not get into supernature, does not get into other dwelling places that much. He drops little hints here and there. Different lives, he does drop hints, not hints, but directly says, you know, we don't want to be overwhelmed with too much information as we're exchanging one belief system for another. We don't want to be overwhelmed by too much. It's very difficult to exchange belief systems. So he does not include everything there. This is more important to get your new belief system, get used to a new belief system. That's the most important, because without doing that, you're not going anywhere. Once you're comfortable to some extent with a new belief system, I'm not entirely comfortable with it yet, but to some extent, then it's possible to be clued in to, hey, you know, here's some options. So generally speaking, on this planet, there's not much talk about other place dwelling places. There's not much talk like that. That doesn't mean that there are those who are ignorant of it. Those who know, they know the situation. It's just it overburdens people. Because they start thinking, maybe we should develop technology and travel there. And it's easy to get distracted from exchanging your belief system. Very easy to get distracted. It's better to say, yeah, you're stuck here for now, but if you change your belief system, you realize you won't be so stuck. And then, use it as motivation. Use it as motivation. So I don't have any specifics of what might take place here, but they just use that as a motivation to keep getting clearer and clearer. We can dig something else up along as we're working on this. This is a very condensed fourth phase teaching. This is. So the teaching tends to get more condensed as you go along. Don't process it intellectually. Don't short circuit the whole thing. There's a problem with that that I've spoken of before, where you feel like, hey, well, this is a huge problem. I don't know if I should even talk about it. I've mentioned it so many times. Trying to be a big shot in this world. Trying to run cover for the nature worshippers who are really, really very dictatorial and tyrannical and harsh. Trying to soften it up, and you think you have a really high position if you just soften it up for the people who are really enslaved. And if you hold a whole bunch of spiritual lingo, you can, be a big shot in this world by running interference and smoothing over. You know how, like, tyrants always have those around them who smooth things out. As they get into a tantrum and do terrible things and, oppressive stuff, you have the spin doctors and doctoresses and spinning spin doctors. So what happens is you might be tempted to become a really, really good spin doctor, and you'll have a high position within nature, but you'll get buyer's remorse on that too, for sure. Probably very quickly, once the tyrant turns on you and says, hey, you're not spinning it good enough. And you might say, well, you need to mellow out here. You're like too much of a tyrant. And they say, boom. Now your job is to spin it so the people think I'm wonderful. So you work for the higher-ups in this whole paradigm of nature worshiping and a belief in nature. They're going to put the pressure on you. And your job is to fool the public, and that's a very nasty job, actually. And you could read something like this and get sophisticated, in some ways, with this, enough to convince foolish people that that God intends them to be enslaved here and support the higher ups and all that stuff. But that's a misuse of it, obviously. You have to really be willing to take it as a totality and let it get under your skin and suffer the ordeal of that. You could say, do it with love. I mean, like, let it be what it is. You see, when you read something like this, don't try to turn it into something different. Don't try to amalgamate it as part of your spin doctor program. But take it for what it is. Just let it be what it is. There's like, wow. That causes me to be like, wow. I can't spin that. Don't spin it. Don't spin it. That's another way of putting it. Full stop in the now is a way of saying, don't spin it. Don't try to figure out, okay, how can I spin this? How can I include this in some program of being a spin doctor? Don't spin it. Don't spin it. Don't spin it. Just let it be. And of course, it's going to cause a feeling of ordeal. because it's so potent. It's a very pure expression of the new belief system, the alternative beliefs, the optional belief system that leads to ultimately true salvation. And it's going to be agitating and unsettling to us for sure. And just let it be. Let it be. Don't struggle. Let it be. When the mind is not conceived as oneself within, there is nothing to grasp and nothing to become attached. And all habitual assumptions about conditioned existence subside. And the quote-unquote person to be reborn in samsara, in the realm of nature, vanishes. At this point, where outer and inner are both like the sky, delusive experience cannot be conceived or imagined, and we have arrived at the Dharmakaya vision, touching final resolution, coming and going now barred. We reach the supreme citadel of the Dharmakaya, the pure fields of the all-good, the all-saturating matrix. And so you just let that be. Just let it be. And we kind of get it. You can feel it. Like, wow. Something within gets it. The fact that the superficial doesn't get it doesn't matter. Don't try to spin it. Because we're going towards this. We're going towards when we can actually realize this. And we'll see this. Of course, it's completely obvious. Totally self-evident. This is really totally self-evident, all of this. Regarding the vision of reality, unmoving in the quiescent ground, no outside, no inside exists. No elaborations of perceptual duality. No elaborations of perceptual duality. And since there is no mind that fixates, quote-unquote, objects as other, nothing exists to get a hold of. And no attachment to perception, and nowhere in samsara to take rebirth. There's only the sky. There's only the sky. So this is so abstract, isn't it? So abstract. There's only the sky. So with no need to when the mind is not conceived as oneself within, there is nothing to grasp and nothing to become attached, and all habitual assumptions about conditioned existence subside, and the person, quote-unquote person, to be reborn in samsara vanishes. So rebirth, the reason why we get free of it is the person to be reborn vanishes. I had this experience a while ago. Before I was going to go to sleep, I was sitting on the bed, and I suddenly realized that the person, the self, the person we call the person, had vanished. And I said, wow, that's good. I'm not going to go look for it. And of course, if the person has vanished, there's no reason to be. How can you be reborn? How can this person be reborn when it's vanished? It cannot. So these glimpses happen when you're working in this fourth phase. You get the glimpses of the fourth phase. The experience hasn't repeated itself. I wish it would. I hope that you know. Better experiences keep coming, but so just let this just be. Don't struggle, just let it permeate you. It's like you're drinking. Don't talk while you're drinking, right? It's like you're drinking water. Just imagine you're still drinking it in. So don't talk while you're drinking, so to speak. Don't think while you're drinking. Don't talk, just let it, just keep pouring this truth in like you're drinking. and you become hydrated with truth, hydrated with it. We don't need perceptual duality. We can drop perceptual duality, which means inside and outside. There's a perceiver that's inside, and then there's perception that's outside. Actually, there's not neither. Again, drink, don't struggle. Watch yourself very carefully as you're reading, as you're considering. Don't let yourself struggle. When you feel struggles coming up, just okay, back off a little bit. So I sitting quietly without saying anything about thinking is great. You're in a state of no struggle. Even though something within you is like, seems to be struggling, don't struggle with the struggle. Don't give form to the struggle. Just let this feeling of struggle just be there. Just and let it sort of dissipate. It will dissipate if you don't try to feed it. Through words and thinking and past and future and imagination. Don't feed it that way. Just looking to see here. Okay, so here's a perfect admonition. In short, all conscious sensory perception and all that is unconscious or transcendent, everything is already released in the spaciousness of the now. So any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous. It is pointless to try and make effort towards release. So don't try. Don't try. Don't struggle and strive in practice. Don't seek, don't seek, don't seek intellectual truth. Don't meditate, don't meditate, don't contrive meditation. Don't analyze, don't analyze, don't analyze in or after an event. Don't practice, don't practice, don't practice the upshot of hope and fear. Don't reject, don't reject, don't reject emotional karma. Don't believe, don't believe, don't believe in righteous religion. Don't trap yourself, don't trap yourself, don't cage your mind. So don't repress the emotional karma. Is this feeling of ordeal and burn comes up, don't repress it. Just say, okay, bringing it up is a good thing. But don't struggle with it either. Don't contrive meditation about it, just let it be. Don't inside, outside it. Don't inside, outside it. Don't take a position on it. Don't take a viewpoint on it. Just let it be what it is. Love is, love is, love is. There's no inside to it. There's no outside to it. Reality doesn't have an inside. It doesn't have an outside. Everything is already released in the now. The matrix of pure spaciousness. There's no inside or outside. We cannot contrive to. We can contrive to try to make one, but don't try to contrive that. See, the levels and the paths are already released in the now. Are released in the now. Liberated in the absence of creative and fulfillment stages. View and meditation are released in the now, liberated in non-discrimination. So viewpoints, meditation, as you know, inside, outside, that's all released in the now, already released. It is again Do not attempt to liberate anything anew. So any attempt to liberate anything anew is superfluous. It's trying to make happiness happy, trying to make silence silent, trying to make truth true, trying to make life life, trying to make reality reality. There's no need to do that. So we're engaged in a superfluous effort, thinking that it's necessary. It's not necessary. Thinking that if we don't do it, we won't have it. See, this is the trouble. When Jesus says we make our own death. Of course, if we're trying to make life life, we're really believing in our own death, because we think we need to make it. The notion and concept of death. Trying to make love love, we get the concept of lack of love. Hatred or something. So we make a duality out of reality when we're trying to make reality real. Reality doesn't need a realizer. It doesn't need a realizer. Say, oh, you're real. Truth doesn't need truth. Reality doesn't need reality. Peace doesn't need peace. Love doesn't need love. Faith doesn't need faith. Reality doesn't need a realizer. Reality has no needs. It just is. There's no inside and outside to it. There's no position or view. It doesn't need a position. Does not need a viewpoint. Reality doesn't need a viewpoint. Don't try to develop a viewpoint on this. Don't try to develop a viewpoint on truth. Or success. Reality doesn't need success. Reality doesn't have any viewpoint on success. So this four-state teachings are helpful for those who have already gone through the first three stages and are used to not struggling. They realize it doesn't work. And just let it be. Just let it be what it is. Love just is. It's not editorializing experience into categories. I'm still feeling some resistance for myself, so I have to keep working here, but without struggling. Keep in mind, getting used to this belief system gives us options. Trying to loosen a tooth, you know, is trying to get something, like you have something stuck in your tooth and you're trying to get your tongue, you're trying to get it out, you just can't get it unstuck, and finally you keep working at it for hours and finally it comes unstuck, and up to that point you just feel, wow, I'm never going to get it unstuck, but finally somehow you dislodge it. So there's this, I feel it's just complex, this good and evil, this battle of light and dark, you know, that is thinking that it needs to triumph, and that it needs to be there for reality to be the, to be what it is, you know, and it's not true, but it's the residue of habit of the old belief system is still there, and I've been working to, you know, dislodge this, you know, get free of it, so to speak. I realize it doesn't need to be dislodged at all. So hopefully that can happen. All right, so this is enough. A lot of videos to watch. And remember, it's a matter of familiarity and comfort and not struggling and letting it be what it is. So we know there is another belief system and we know we can get used to it. So there's options. If we think we can't get used to it, then we'll be afraid of supernature. Say, oh no, I'll never be able to get used to that. So we're stuck here with this delusion of nature. So if we keep proving to ourselves we can get used to this, we can get used to it. Prove it to yourself, prove it to yourself, prove it to yourself. Every day, prove it to yourself. Gradually you start saying, hey, yeah, I can do this. This is something that I can get used to this. Okay, it's that simple. I can get used to this. All right, very great, that's it.